Sometimes a high-performance industrial network like Profinet isn't necessary. In many cases, a slower, yet more cost-effective solution is more than sufficient. And that's exactly where good old Modbus RTU shines. From drive's perspective, you don't need anything additional. Every ACS-X80 drive has a built-in RS485 interface with Modbus RTU support. From PLC's perspective, at least if we're talking about AC500 Eco, you would only need TA5142 RS485 option board. No runtime license are needed, and even basic edition of Automation Builder will work. Now to the drive configuration. Go to group 58, embedded Fieldbus, and select Modbus RTU. It will take a while until drive composer loads and displays new set of parameters. First, you need to give the device node address. You might have heard terms like slave address or server address. In the context of Modbus RTU, it is the same thing, a unique identifier of a device connected to Modbus RTU line. Now, baud rate, parity, and data stop bits. The specific value you choose isn't as important as ensuring that the settings are identical on both the drive and PLC side. We have already talked about profiles in the previous episode. The link to it is going to be somewhere up here, so go and watch it. And make sure ABB drives is selected as control profile. We don't need to read actual speed or frequency twice. Therefore, you can change EFP Act 2 type to torque. Little bit about Modbus protocol in general. From Modbus master perspective, slave device is a long list of 16-bit halting registers, which master can read or write. Depending on what master wants to do with registers in the slave device, different Modbus functions are used. For example, if master wants to read value of several registers, it sends a request to a slave with Modbus code 3, and slave replies with values of those registers. If master wants to write values to several registers, it would use Modbus function 16. Yes, I know, there are also bit data types and associated with them Modbus functions. But nowadays, those are either not supported or have limited functionality. So let's just focus on holding registers. Speaking of which, ACS-X80 drives have following register map. From address 0 to 13 located data I/O 1 to 14 registers. At address 89 to 94 sitting various diagnostics related registers. And then from address 100 onwards mapped all drives parameters. Modbus address is derived from group and parameter number using this formula. For example, address for motor torque would be 1 multiplied by 100 plus 10 minus 1, which is equal 109. Address for DI status register would be 10 by 100 plus 1 minus 1, 1000. Or address for acceleration ramp would be 28 by 100 plus 72 minus 1, which is 2871. You probably already see where I'm going with this. Addresses of these registers in most of the cases are not going one after another, which means that you must send the separate request to read each register's unit. And that's exactly why you have these 14 data I/O registers. First three by default are mapped to control and reference purposes. Next three are mapped for status and feedback. And all other you can use for your own needs. For example, get DC bus voltage or status of digital inputs of the drive. One remark on Modbus address notation. While browsing through drive's documentation, you will see that register address is shown in a different way. For example, data IO1 has address 400001. It is so-called modicon notation. technically, it is outdated, but many vendors still use it because it incorporates both data type, 4 stands for holding register, and address. To get IC address, that's what PLC operates with, you need to remove 400.001 part, which leaves us with address 0. Okay, back to drive configuration. We need to make sure that control and reference locations are set to embedded fieldbus. Parameter 2001 to embedded fieldbus. Parameter 2211 to EFB ref 1. And finally, parameter 2811 to EFB ref 1 as well. Now it's time to jump to PLC configuration. Find option slot 2 and add a new object to it. Select category serial protocols and then one of the RS485 options. Now go to settings of the added option board and make sure that parameters like baud rate, parity, data and stop bits are the same as in drive's configuration. Next, you need to let PLC know which protocol is used with added serial line. Right-click on serial COM and add Modbus RTU client. In other words, PLC will act as Modbus master on this serial line. Unlike with Profinet I/O, with Modbus RTU, you need to program communication exchange. For that, you would need libraries, drives, and Modbus RTU. In drive control section, add a box and then find drive Modbus RTU function block in drives library. Basically, what this function block does is it writes control word, reference 1 and reference 2 to the drive, and then reads status word, actual 1 and actual 2 from the drive, and then packs it into one data structure called drive data. Let's have a closer look on it. Line token is a variable which allows to share access between several communication blocks. It means that the same variable instance must be connected to all drive Modbus RTU function blocks. Drive data, as already mentioned, is a structure where drive's control and status information is packed. COM, number of serial line the drive is connected to. In case of AC500 ECO, it is the number of option slot, which is 2. Server, this is drive's node address. Remember, we set it to 2 in drive's composer. Timeout, time within which slave should respond. Reconnect pause. Wait interval after which PLC will try to request data again. Enhanced profile. Can only be used with additional FSCA01 adapter. Number var read. Besides 3 status registers, you can specify how many additional registers, starting from data 7, you want to read. We need 3. And then you need to store the additional data somewhere. That's where read value array comes into play. And now we try it out. Load the project to the PLC and set it to run. Set enable input to true and it doesn't work. Well, let's switch to drive composer and try to figure out what's going on. Parameter group 58 gives us extensive set of tools to debug serial communication. Some of them are packet and error counters. You can see that drive does not receive any packets, but UART errors counter is rising, which means that controller sends requests, but somehow they are corrupted or distorted along the way. You can also see it by indicators on the communication board. TXD indicator blinks, then waits for timeout interval and tries again. There could be different reasons for such behavior, but most likely it is caused by wrongly connected plus minus wires of RS485 line. If I swap the wires on either PLC or drive side, you will see that UART errors counter stops, and now all packets counters start to count. But that's still not what we want. Basically, what happens is a drive can read packets sent in the line, but those messages are addressed to someone else. How could that happen? Well, likely it is another common mistake. In order drive to accept new embedded fieldbus settings, you need to power cycle it or flip parameter 5806 to refresh. Yeah, now it looks like it. Switch back to Automation Builder. Output online indicates that PLC successfully reads information from the drive. If you expand drive data structure, you will see value of status word. If you go to read values array, you will see two parts of voltage value and status of drive digital inputs. Okay, it's good and it's a step in the right direction, but we're only communicating with the drive. The next step would be to control it. Add a function block called drive control modbus ACS. And you can see that it looks quite like the function block we use for Profinet. The only difference is how you connect control and status words. Instead of separate variables, it's packed in one structure, drive data. Let's also do reference scaling. Actual speed FB we can take from drive control modbus ACS function block. Actual torque FB as well, and then connect scaled speed reference back to control function block. And before logging to the PLC again, I'd like to show you a neat trick which is especially useful during debugging process. If you add a visualization page, of course, name it somehow, on the right in the toolbox panel, you will find sections with the same name as connected libraries, Modbus RTU and drives. In the drive section, you will find visualization elements which have names like the function blocks we've used. If you drag and drop drive Modbus RTU element, it will look like inputs and outputs of the function block organized in two columns. First, it will ask you to connect Visu element to the instance of the function block. And then you can move and resize it to your liking. Let's do the same for drive control function block and for scaling, so we can give a reference speed to the drive. Okay. And the magic begins when you log into the PLC. Inputs and outputs show actual values and change color according to their state. So instead of scrolling the program, you can have a bird's eye view here. Let's give drive a reference speed, 50% for example. Speed ref value also changes. Reset fault, give a run command, and we see drive is working. Until it doesn't. Okay, let's check what Drive Composer has to say about it. Okay, it says EFB communication loss, but communication is there. And you know what? I think I know what the problem is. Drive Modbus RTU function block sends write request only if there is a change in reference or control word. If since the last request those values are not changed, function block will only read status information. But parameters 5815 tells us that drive will trip into communication fault if there were no write request to control word, reference 1 or reference 2 within 3 seconds interval. And since we can't control how function block works, we only can change parameter 5815 to any message, which will make drive trip only if there is no read or write requests within 3 seconds interval. And don't forget to refresh settings. Go back to Automation Builder, reset the fault and start the drive. Seems like there is no fault. Let's change the reference, try to increase the load and wait for at least 3 seconds. Good. Now, what if you want to write some parameters to the drive? Say you want to change acceleration and deceleration ramps. Let's see. It has nothing to do with value parameters writing, but we forgot to combine two voltage words into floating point value. Okay, back to writing. Add a function block, drive modbus write. Connect drive data structure so the function block can work with drive modbus RTU block. And now you can specify number of variables you want to write. 2. Next step is to let function block know which parameter you want to access in the drive. Acceleration and deceleration ramps for scalar control are sitting in the group 28, parameters 72 and 73. That means that the input parameter number must be 2872, And don't worry about Modbus address notation. It's taken care inside the function block. The last step is to specify where the data is coming from. Declare an array and take a pointer to it through the address operator. Go online, prepare new values for acceleration and deceleration ramps. And here you might ask a question, but what is the scaling? That is a very good question. So if you go to drive's firmware manual and find parameter 2872, you will see so-called Fieldbus equivalent 16 expression, which means that if you write value 10, drive will take it as a 1 second ramp. So if you want ramps to be 2.5 and 2.8 seconds, you should send values 25 and 28. When you flip execute input, function block will generate write job and put it to queue. And then communication block, once it has time, will send actual Modbus write request. Output job done will indicate that operation finished successfully. You can verify it in Drive Composer. We could have stopped here. What we have already covered will be enough for a majority of cases. But I would like to make a step into the realm of Modbus optimization. Here is what I mean by that. As you have seen, write requests are not executed cyclically. Of course, you can make it work cyclically by connecting the output job done to the input execute. But let's count how many Modbus requests we would have per each drive. First, read status. Second, write reference if reference has changed. Third, write additional parameters. Doesn't seem like much, but add one more parameter to write and multiply it by 5 drives and delay becomes noticeable. Make number of drives 10 and delays start to be a problem. One might say, just switch to the Ethernet. But sometimes you have to work with what you've got. So here's an idea how we can optimize this communication and control. We have 14 data I/O registers, probably enough to keep all needed cyclic data. Now we just need to read and write that data in one request. Thankfully, ACS X80 drive and AC500 PLC support Modbus function 23, which does both reading and writing in one Modbus request. So let's get to work. First step is to reconfigure data I/O registers in drive so data we read and data we write are located together. For example, from register 11 to 14 mapped control word, ref1 and 2 ramp values. We didn't use reference 2, so there is no need to map it. From register 1 to 6 mapped status word actual1, actual2, DC voltage and input status. Second step, we need to read and write data. Go to Modbus RTU library and add mod RTU token function block. This one is similar to what we had for drive communication. Next, add mod RTU read write 23 function block, which reads 6 registers starting from address 0. Remember, data IO1 has Modbus register 0. And writes 4 registers starting from address 10. Both read and write data is stored into 2 arrays. Let's see how it looks like online. So communication is working. There is a status word, voltage and digital input state. Now give acceleration and deceleration ramps some values and check them in Drive Composer. Yeah, it works. And now we just repeat the same we did for PropNet. Add drive control ACS function block, connect status and comment variables, add scaling function block and connect actual values and reference. Add voltage conversion, go online and give drive a reference and comment. Enjoy it running. As I said, you probably will not use this approach very often, but it's good to know that there is another way, just for the sake of flexibility. Okay, hope you liked it. If you did, give us a thumbs up and share this episode with colleagues and friends. Cheers!